Well, I want to review a little bit from last week, and especially since we have guests and members this morning that weren't here for last week's message. What I was doing was walking through the various churches that Paul wrote letters to, because each individual church had its own specific issue or concern or joy that Paul was lifting up. So we looked at the church in Rome, which was focusing on intellect and theology and the message of salvation. We focused on the church at Corinth, which had a lot of problems, so Paul was solving problems there. The focus for the church at Galatia was a correction in teaching. They were straying from the true message of salvation by faith alone, and they were starting to adopt a theology of salvation by works. And so Paul needed to make sure that he was correcting the representatives at Galatia so they did not stray from the true message of the gospel. The church at Philippi, which I focused on mostly last week, which I believe Heidelberg is the most like, if I were to make an analogy between the churches in the New Testament and the churches today. A place where Paul could be upbeat, joyous, triumphant, and optimistic about its members and the ministry happening there. This brings us to the church at Thessalonica. I know some people pronounce it Thessalonica, but in Greek it would be Thessaloniki, and just for the purpose of clarification, I will pronounce it in the American way, Thessalonica. We learn from Paul's letters that it was a church under persecution, but also a church that had a dynamic testimony. It had grown despite persecution. Paul's purposeful letter was to comfort and motivate its church members with the truth of the Lord's imminent return. There was a population of about 200,000 people living there, mostly consisting of Greeks, with a large population of Romans, and a strong Jewish minority. The city was captured by Rome in 168 BC. So this lays the foundation for understanding of what actually was happening in this church at the time and why persecution was so profound there. You can probably sense the undercurrent of predominantly Greek people being taken over by the Romans. So you can imagine if the Romans came into America today and took over our country and then expected us to do what they wanted us to do. There would be a feeling of loss of culture and customs which the Jewish people were experiencing. It became a major city for the Roman military. The Roman government was, you know, a big military power. So the Romans taking over was something that was part of the undercurrent of what people were feeling at the time. The positive thing was that the giving these people more wealth, it was an industrious city, and an opportunity to make a nice living. So the people were not impoverished there for the most part. The downside of the culture there was the fact that most of the people were living immoral lives. They were living with a lot of evil. So because of this, the Apostle Paul made a special exhortation for holy living. That was really a focus there. According to Luke, the converts at Thessalonica included Jews and a great multitude of devout Greeks, and they really liked the piousness, the righteousness of the gospel of monotheism and the morality of Judaism. So some of the believers were of the upper class, but most were apparently of the working class. We get a clue of that because Paul refused to accept any financial aid while he was there. So as the Jews became converts to Christianity, the accusation of treason was placed upon the apostles from those who bowed down to Caesar. And those of you that were in John's class this morning in the adult Sunday school class, this is going to be echoing the sense of what you were hearing John talk about with the sense of treason that Martin Luther was also accused of. So this is probably why Paul was writing to the Thessalonian residents there with a focus on eschatology. Here you are going through persecution now, but keep your eyes focused on what is to come, on life after this life. Yes, you're being persecuted now, but because of Christ's life and death and resurrection, you are guaranteed a place, eternal place, of peace and love and grace and freedom. The majority of the converts came from paganism, so you can understand that they really needed to be taught in holy living. They were surrounded with a culture of heathenism and gross immorality, which led to enormous temptation to return to their old ways and significant persecution if they refused to recant their faith in Christ. Paul was expelled from Philippi, Thessalonica, and from one Macedonian city after another as a troublemaker. Paul and his team had been forced to leave the young converts in Macedonia abruptly and quite inadequately, equipped with the instruction and encouragement necessary to enable them to stand firm in the face of determined opposition. So the question remained, would their immature faith prove equal to the challenge? And the answer, quite incredibly, is that it did. Now, we know most of my sermons aren't usually historical and historically based. So those of you that like history, this is going to be something different for you. Those that don't like history, I don't do this every Sunday. So bear with me, please. The church actually became an illustrious success, but at the time when Paul was compelled to leave, it must have felt to him like it was heartbreaking failure. By the spring of AD 50, Timothy's report on Thessalonica was so encouraging that Paul wrote 1 Thessalonians almost immediately. He was inspired by their spiritual stamina in the face of fierce persecution and opposition. In studying this epistle, we can see commonalities between Paul's ministry in charge and the Reverend Martin Luther as we celebrate Reformation Sunday today and this year. We can see the similarities in Luther wanting the church to be pure and holy. We can see the similarities in Luther being exiled from the church, but in Luther's case, it was the Roman Catholic Church. We can see Luther going before the church leaders with a strong, persistent faith. Luther's intention was never to be exiled from the church, but only to point out reforms for which he saw incorrect teachings. Luther was obviously seen as a troublemaker in the Catholic Church, challenging those in authority. His heart for the message of the gospel would not allow him to remain silent. After nailing his 95 theses to the church door at Wittenberg, which pointed out two primary beliefs, that the Bible is the central religious authority and that humankind may reach salvation only by their faith and not by their deeds, the religious authorities had to react to his declarations. In addition to these two primary beliefs, Luther was challenging the practice of the Catholic indulgences, where the priests would guilt people into believing that they could pay to have their sins forgiven, with the proceeds going to fund the building of St. Peter's Basilica. Luther obviously saw this as it was, scandalous. Luther's purpose for posting the 95 theses in his mind was for teaching, discussion, and correction. But on November 9th, 1518, the Pope condemned Luther's writings as conflicting with the teachings of the church. And 1 year later, a series of commissions were convened to examine Luther's teachings. The First Papal Commission found them to be heretical. But the second merely stated that Luther's writings were scandalous and offensive to pious ears. Finally, in July 1520, Pope Leo X issued a public decree that concluded that Luther's propositions were heretical and gave Luther 100 days to recant in Rome. Luther refused to recant. And on January 3rd, 1521, Pope Leo excommunicated Martin Luther from the Catholic Church. On April 17th, 1521, Luther appeared before the Diet of Worms in Germany. Refusing again to recant, Luther concluded his testimony with a defiant statement, "Here I stand. God help me. I can do no other." On May 25th, the Holy Roman Emperor Charles V signed an edict against Luther, ordering his writings to be burned. Luther hid in the town of Eisenach for the next year, where he began work on one of his major life projects, the translation of the New Testament into German, which took him 10 years to complete. Because of the work he did to bring the Bible into the hands of the people, we are able to read the Holy Scriptures today in our own language. The invention of the printing press also made this possible. And of course, our members and friends in the UCC look to another reformer living in Switzerland, Ulrich Zwingli, who also joined forces to reform the teachings of the Roman Catholic Church. And in Strasbourg, Germany, John Calvin ministered to French refugees with the tenets of Protestant theology, eventually expanding his message into Geneva and throughout Europe. Then 200 years later, John Wesley was responsible for the Reformation of the Anglican Church and established the Methodist Church in England and America. We have come a long way since the days of the Reformers. In fact, we are celebrating, as I said, 500 years of the Reformation this year. If there is one thing we can glean from these devout ministers of the gospel, it is that their love of God and their desire for truth inspired them to challenge corruption in the church. As Martin Luther was asked to recant, his words continue to echo today.
As I have been called before Charles V, the Holy Roman Empire Emperor of Europe, and the bishops of Germany sent by the Pope to represent him, asking me to recant of my writings and my teachings that were only to reform the church, not to destroy the church. I was on trial for heresy, the punishment of which was to be burned at the stake alive. I gave my response to the emperor, to the holy bishops. Unless I am convinced by scripture, and not by popes or church councils, which so often have contradicted themselves, my conscience is held captive to the word of God. I cannot, and I will not, recant. Here I stand. I can do no other. God help me.